Hello everyone, this is Inter. Welcome back to another electric plane video. There are two major reasons I'm making this video. One is because the previous one was really long and not very eventful, and I took too long explaining things. And the other is because I've greatly improved the engine design, and the plane now flies a lot faster than it used to, and the performance is just great. So I was prompted to make this video because just a couple of days ago I was browsing on YouTube and came across a video of a plane that looked almost identical to one I had made earlier in my previous prop plane video, and it was being showcased on a Guard 13007's channel. I'm not exactly sure how he pronounces his channel name, but he comes out with some pretty good KSP stuff from time to time. So I was checking it out, and I saw how good the plane was and realized that the plane I had showed to the world in my previous video was really crap. And I have been continuing to mess around with this and improve and refine the design. So just want to show you guys what I have here. Now, in my previous video, I mentioned that I learned about this technique from watching Veos do it on a live stream. And at the time, Veos was trying to compact the engine into a single cylinder like we have here. Whereas Mr. Nuclear Turkey, I believe the person who originally came up with the idea, or at least as far as I was aware through Veos, Mr. Nuclear Turkey was using two cylinders. Now, somebody commented in my previous video that this technique has been around for a long time, of using SAS modules, you know, reaction wheel modules, to create torque and do electric planes. This idea is not new, it's been around since like 2013, and I'm just living under a rock, as usual. So I was just going along with the flow and thinking, well, hey, two cylinders provides more leverage from front to back, so it should be, you know, it should create a more stable engine. And I was right, it did. If you were using just one ball bearing at either end, in the form of a single Stay Putnik probe at either end, something Veos was doing when he was trying to make a single cylinder engine was he was trying to use multiple ball bearings on either end. And turns out that actually can work, but it's very finicky. So I've played around with it and figured out how to make it work. So I'm going to show that to you guys right now. And obviously after I've spent a couple of minutes showing this to you guys, we will take the plane out and I'll show you how much better it is. So for building things like this, I find it helps to have all the pieces you need sort of sitting around on standby. And you can just hold down Alt and left click, assuming you're on a Windows machine, and you can copy the pieces you need and stick them in. Now for this, for everything to do with these engines, we do need to turn on part clipping because we're working in very, very confined spaces, and we need to take advantage of every opportunity to attach things on either side of an attachment point. And as before, the first thing you're going to need is a separatron so you can separate the plane from the engine, or vice versa. So, separatron goes in, and I like to put it on the inside of the engine, and that just gives me a little bit of better sense of what the spacing is, and then I can, you know, slide it in or out using the translational tools as need be. So we take our first SAS piece, throw it in, and I found that the length of an engine inside these single cylinders is about two of the generators. That's really all you have room for. Which doesn't sound like a lot, and that's right, it's not a lot, but we'll find a way to work around that. So you see with just two of these generators in here, we have a little bit of room to spare on either end. We have the separatron space and the little gap right here at the end. Because this is such a confined space, I'm going to extend this out beyond the length of the fuselage so you can see what I'm doing. Now, the technique Veos was trying to do with the ball bearings, the way he was going about it was he was using, I think, like three, and the idea was that you didn't want to have too many creating friction on the inside. Well, I've actually found that the opposite is true. You want to be consuming as much of the space on the inside of the cylinder as possible, because if there's any sort of gap between the wall of the inner wall of the cylinder and the Stay Putnik probes rubbing around the inside, if there's any sort of gap, the physics in KSP will exploit that gap and start shaking the engine apart, creating lots of vibrations, and the engine will sort of start jerking in the air and losing rotational velocity and causing loss of thrust. So to get around that, we actually have to have the state buttocks pressing very, very close to the inner wall, like virtually touching. So the way I did that was I took one of these, threw it in there, and of course used the translational tool to get it where it needed to be as far as clearance to the end of the cylinder goes. I'm not going to cover that again in detail. That was all in my previous video. I don't want to waste too much of your time here. So moved it where I needed to have it. Then I copied it up to 8 times. And yeah, that was an adventure. So copied it 8 times. And then grabbed the cylinder, or the generator on the inside. Now this took a bit of patience, because it's very difficult to grab the one you need. You just sort of have to get your mouse in there and start exploring and see which one highlights at the correct time. There we go, I think I've got it now. So I've got the correct one highlighted, and now all I have to do is move it in or out to get the walls of the state buttock to touch the inside of the cylinder. I've already done that in the engine up here, so I'm just going to show you instead of trying to recreate it. As you can see, there are 8 state buttock probes here, but they are so close together they almost look like a single ball, and that's actually a really good thing. You also note, if you look closely, there's virtually no gap whatsoever between the state buttock probes and the wall. Now, originally I had thought, well, if we don't want any gap, why don't I just extend the state buttocks so they are more expanded, spread farther apart, so they're actually going into the wall of the cylinder and totally eliminating any sort of gap. Well, when I did that, friction did end up being a very serious problem, and the state buttock probes caught onto the cylinder walls even more, and like I said, that jerking action happened. The engine would stop rotating very briefly for like fractions of a second, and thrust would be lost, and the plane would crash. So obviously that's not something we want to have happen. So the critical part is to have as little gap as possible, basically just touching the edge of the wall, but not going through it. And this is what we end up with. Now, of course, if you're going to be doing this full on, you want to have all of your little SAS modules on the inside, positioned wherever you can get them. And like I said, that goes into more detail than I want to cover in this video. You can go back and watch the previous video if you want to see how I arranged everything in here. What I should have done, and I'm not really proud of not having done it, was I should have rotated the cylinders like this so they were all perpendicular, and then gotten them into a formation like that. That's what they should look like in the inside of the engine. But I didn't do it for some reason, so maybe not having as much torque as I could. But it still ended up being a pretty powerful plane. So that was the basics of building the engine. Now let's take this thing out and see how it flies. Okay, there are quite a few buttons to press. I've started doing click counts, which is something you do in software development, counting how many clicks there are so that users don't get frustrated. And I'm up to like 14 or 15 clicks, combination clicks and key presses, to get this thing going, but you gotta do it. So this throttle is a pet peeve of mine, and I know that's been fixed in 1.2, but I'm still in 1.1.3 right now. So just kill the throttle and parking brake on. Now at this point, you can do it now or you can do it later, but the air intake on the front is simply for looks. So I do like to close it to remove any sort of drag that it might be creating. And now at this point, it's best to separate the engine from the craft. So I hit spacebar to stage out my little decoupler here. And fortunately, it's positioned in such a way along the bottom of the fuselage that it has a good deal of repulsion and just smacks right into the runway and destroys itself. So very helpful that. Now at this point, we are controlling the plane, because you can see Jebediah down here. So I'm going to keep parking brake on. I'm going to turn on SAS. And there are a couple of generators inside these little ballast tanks here, and I'm going to raise the flaps. There we go. I start them deployed because I found in KSP, if you try to deploy things after the fact, sometimes the flaps will arbitrarily swap directions of which way they deploy. But I found if I launch the craft with the deployable things already deployed, then they retain that deployment orientation throughout the duration of the flight, or at least until I have to come back and reload the craft. So, raise flaps. Now we're going to hit right bracket and switch over to the engine. And I put a probe core on the front because there were so many stay buttonic things on the inside. You remember from my last video, I only had one stay buttonic on either end of the shaft. Well, this time I have 8, so I didn't want the orientation to be sliding around, you know, rotating with a single stay buttonic. So I put one on the front that's directly in the center, in line with the shaft, and I control from here, and that should help to stabilize orientation. The propellers I already put at the highest pitch setting, and if I deploy them, this actually almost feathers them, so it's better for cruising. You won't get the max speed out of this, but it reduces drag when you're already in flight and cruising. Of course, you don't have to have deployed that much. You can reduce the deployment if you want. But anyway, I put them on there with a default orientation before deployment of already having the best forward speed. That's set to go. Don't really need parking brake anymore. And now we can start trimming it out. So again, just holding down Alt and doing the right roll key to trim it, so when I let go of the keyboard, it continues to spin. Now go back to the plane. SAS is on, flaps are up, we can let go of the parking brake, and what I'm really happy about with this craft is the engine is so powerful, I think I can get over the VAB before, you know, before actually reaching it. So let's see what happens here. Now on my screen, because I'm recording with Fraps, the engine looks like it's behaving really poorly, but I know it's not. This thing works pretty darn well. There we go, back wheels off. Front wheels are just coming up. Let's lift up, wheels away, and we can go straight over there. 30 is about stall speed, so I'm trying to stay above that. But the engine is so powerful that I can get a pitch up attitude of like 10 real degrees on the prograde, and it will still maintain whatever velocity I put it at. But I'm going for about 15 right now on the bearing reticle, getting about 7 or 8 degrees of the prograde, and that's pretty good. We're over the VAB. That was something I could never do with the previous engine. Of course, it also probably helps that I balanced the center of lift and the center of mass of this craft a lot better. Like when you take if you take the propeller blades off, you can see where the true center of lift is when the craft is riding along, and that's just a good way of balancing it. So I did try to balance things pretty well on this. All right, let's turn on aero forces and see what we got. All right, lots of pretty things. I added a couple of extra elevators back here to try to reduce the amount of drag they were creating to keep the plane, you know, nose up above prograde, and I think it worked all right. So if I'm just in level flight, let me get the nose down just a little bit. You can see surface velocity goes above 60, and it'll go to like about 64 if I sit here and let it do that. You know, 64 with an electric engine, completely stock, I think it's pretty good. Now getting back to the ball bearings, look how smoothly the engine is rotating. This is nothing like my previous craft. Yes, there's a bit of vibration and oscillation. It's wiggling a little bit, but nothing like the previous engine. This is, by comparison, an extremely smooth engine. You can see the front battery is keeping almost exactly in position with the fuselage battery. So, I mean, there's almost no separation or loss of orientation at all. If we slip inside the engine, you can see the ball bearings. I mean, these things are doing their job phenomenally well. There's no wiggle whatsoever. It's just, I love this. This engine is so much better. Yeah, so there you go. Now let's see what we can do with it. Unfortunately, because of the ball bearings, the craft is not comfortable at all with using the physics warp. So if I physics warp this thing right now, it would just, the engine would crash, basically. Let's see what happens. Yeah, that's not good. So I could do it with my previous engine, because there was just, like I said, there was just one state button neck at the front and one state button neck at the back, and all I had to do was just bounce around a little bit. So previous craft, you could use physics warp on, but for this one, you need to stay at one times warp, which kind of takes a while. Oh, another nice note. This thing has enough thrust or climb performance, as you will, that it can actually get over the mountains. It can't go all the way clear over the mountains. So you'd have to get up to like 6,000 MSL or better, and this thing just sort of loses performance around 5.5 thousand meters. But you can get up high enough that you can very easily weave between gaps in the mountain peaks over there, which is something that I could not do with the previous engine. That I've showed you. I did improve that engine later on, but it was still a challenge to go anywhere near those mountains. With this one, not a challenge at all. I can do pretty much whatever I want with this plane, as long as I have enough patience to get me there. So this plane has one engine. It's sort of a fighter craft, like you saw in my last video. But going along with what Veos was doing on his live stream, you know, a number of weeks ago, I thought I should try to do something with two of these engines. And I ended up going for a very old-fashioned, sort of bomber-looking biplane. And I was thinking in my head that with two engines, it would perform a heck of a lot better. You know, it'd have twice the power and only a few extra wings and all that jazz, just a little bit extra mass. So I was thinking that it should be able to perform a lot better. And that's not good. Well, okay, let's segue over to that bomber. So I was thinking that it should be able to perform a lot better because it has two engines and not a whole lot more mass. Well, for whatever reason, it doesn't work that way. And for some really odd reason, the left engine consistently develops more thrust, more, you know, forward yellow vector lines, develops more thrust than the right engine. And I can't figure it out. The only way I can get them to equalize is to trim the right engine or the left engine, trim one of them, and that's more work than I like to do. But you may notice they're counter-rotating, so all the torque factors are completely eliminated, which means this plane does fly a lot more smoothly. But because it's dealing with rotating bodies out away from the longitudinal axis, its maneuvering is nowhere near as adept as the fighter's was. It flies much more stably, but its maneuvering is kind of crap. And in the live stream, Veos was trying to get these things to, you know, starting up the engines independently and having the craft take off in a given direction. That was kind of difficult, to say the least. And everybody was telling him, just put one of these things on, what are these called? I've completely forgotten what they're called. Launch Stability Enhancer. Yeah, just put one of the red towers on. And he kind of refused for a while, but I have no shame. I put one on immediately. But I did sort of experiment with it and see how I tried to see how the plane would behave when you were starting up one after the other. And it ended up being that I had to use SAS to hold the first engine. After I completely trimmed the first engine, I had to hold it with SAS so it was locked in position. And then once I got the other engine started up, I would then have to keep the engine going and let the plane rotate around until it was oriented and, you know, realigned with the runway. And then as the active second engine was coming around, I would tab back over to the first engine and release its SAS lock, and then hopefully the plane, if I timed it correctly, would take off in alignment with the runway. So that was obviously more hassle than it was worth, and I ended up going with the red tower here. Okay, so for this, I'm using the exact same engines as I did on the fighter. All I did was copy the engine from the decoupler forward. So it took the decoupler, all the engine bits, and the whole propeller assembly, and I copied it forward and saved that as a subassembly, and then I was just able to take the subassembly and attach it into the new engine cowlings and use the translational tool to slide everything around and make sure everything was realigned. But I copied these engines from a previous iteration of the fighter, so the pitch angle is not quite what it should be. So right now I'm going to hit my hotkey and get both engines to deflect their prop pitch a little bit and get them better prepared for takeoff. There we go. So that's what we need for takeoff power. I'm also, while I have everything attached, I'm going to close all the intakes. Now everything is closed. And these ones are just for looks. And might as well get rid of the flaps. And why is it in the... Oh. I thought that looked a little bit too stable. Alright. So here we go. We got everything ready. Now it's just a matter of detaching everything. And they don't separate nearly as cleanly as the other one did. That one should fall out eventually. And then move over to the engine and do our usual business. So orient from here. And because we have the docking clamp on the back acting as our parking brake, I don't have to try to stop these things from rotating by using the SAS toggle. I can just, you know, let them free spin. So this one turns to the inside. And because the plane is going to be flying with a continuous nose up attitude, it's the downward inner stroke that produces the most thrust, which is helpful because it keeps the thrust closer to the center of the fuselage, and that, again, helps with performance. And then get over to this one, do the same, turning in the opposite direction to go with the direction of the prop pitch. There we go. And let's turn on aero forces and see what's happening. There we go, that looks pretty good. So the yellow pointers are pointing forward ahead of the blade, and that's good because the way this engine behaves, especially on this craft, it needs to be pulling the craft forward. If you start free spinning, you get all this drag action happening in the form of the red arrows, and the engine starts slowing down, they start catching and jerking into the cowling, and it creates all sorts of flight hazards. So the engines, these engines like to be pulling, kind of like some sled dogs or something. They like to be pulling the craft forward. If you just sort of idle along, they start misbehaving. So as soon as we release the clamp parking brake and start moving, these things will gather more speed, the red arrows will gradually diminish, and we should be able to take off. So we are ready. And let's go. There we go, that's pretty clean looking. Those are some big yellow vector lines. There we go, we're already airborne. I wonder if this one can make it over the VAB. Probably not. Although it has two of these very powerful engines, for some reason performance is just not as good as the plane. And, no, I take it back. That did quite well, actually. Nice! But yeah, the top speed is nothing like it was in the fighter. The fighter could get, you know, 63, 64 without much difficulty. This thing struggles to get that high. You have to let it fly for quite a while. But yeah, there we go. This is my twin engine bomber. The view from inside is pretty cool too. Check this out. Oh yeah, sorry. Take this off. Blind as a bat. Your view is completely obstructed. I think that's pretty authentic. Yep. Ooh, another thing I didn't mention was in actual flight, the blades come a lot closer to the fuselage than they did in the hangar. And the reason is because once you start spinning this up, there becomes this gap between the cowling and the propeller blades. You know, centrifugal force kind of pushes the blades or pulls the blades outward, so they want to separate from the engine, so their reach actually becomes broader than it was in the hangar, so you do have to kind of watch out for that. Alright, so here we are, we're in level flight, struggling to do 60, and let's see if we can turn back to the runway, and you'll get a little idea of what the performance is like for this craft. It's not as good as the fighters, but it does, I mean, it does the job. It executes the maneuver. It just doesn't do it as quickly or as gracefully as the fighter did. I have to keep an eye on this one. You want to keep the yellow prograde marker pretty close to the horizon. If you get too high, you'll very quickly get into stall speeds and an aggravated roll, and just it's all kind of badness. And of course, if the yellow goes too far below the horizon line, then you're quickly losing altitude, and then you have to do a very rapid and erratic, you know, evasion maneuver to avoid hitting the ground. So try to keep an eye on the nav ball whenever you're turning with these sorts of things. Oh, also, I had to put a lot of struts on the inside. Like, if you go back inside and just watch the engines, I mean, they are boom, 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 boom. The cowling itself looks like a piston. It doesn't look anything like that in the fighter, I hope. But right now, yeah, they're not very comfortable. Also, the upper wings are not attached to each other. They're only attached to the fuselage. So that could be something to do with it. The cowlings are anchored to the fuselage, not really anchored in place to the wing. All right, now landing this thing is a bit of an issue because you have to go through and basically feather both of the engines, or you can just use SAS and quick halt them, which I do not like to do, but it does work very effectively. And I'm going to come in at kind of a lower speed and get both of my upper and lower flaps going if I can. I'm going to try to go through and feather both of the engines and try to do a nice, gentle touchdown, if I can. Okay, there's that one, and that one. Nice. Oh, that's a little hard. Ooh. Yeah, but we made it. Very nice. Oh, I can show you guys that single engine starting technique now. Now this is just fun. This is, well, I think it's fun. Okay, so here we go. Parking brake is on the plane. We're going to try to start the engines singly now. And you can see, oops, so let go of the keyboard. You can see the plane is not liking that. So I have to keep SAS on brake. And the plane is starting to turn as I get this thing going. Now if I let this go and don't put on SAS, it should turn the plane back around the other way. Actually, hang on. Let's take off brake and see what happens. Turn, turn, turn quickly. Oh god. Oh, where are you? No, this isn't gonna work. I'm gonna hit something. No, bad, very bad. Oh god, no. Get out of here. All right. That's the nice thing about these craft. When they explode, you have so many fragile parts that explode with the greatest of ease. It's just, the explosions on these things are beautiful. Okay, but I'm not going to try to do this again. There you go. There you have it. That was my electric bomber craft. Yay. Thanks, guys. We'll see you again in the future at some point. Hopefully. Stick around. Subscribe, like, comment, all that jazz.